Here we are with Huiyao Wang, founder of the Center for China and Globalization, the biggest independent think tank, and an advisor to the Chinese government. Hello.
Yeah.
Thanks for being here today.
Okay. Thank you.
How's the conference?
Well, I found this conference very actually exciting. I found that it's highly concentrated. A lot of high-level people, a lot of world elite, and it's a great platform. And it's not only necessary to, in the security defense area, but also people from think tank, from business, from a variety of sectors of spectrum of the world. Mm-hmm. So it's gathered here for 2 days. I have a lot of brainstorming, a lot of heads of state, different speeches, and also a lot of group discussions. I was actually at the two panels. One was hosted by BMW Foundation, which I talked with a parliament member of German. He's a chair of the Foreign Relations Committee and also a former deputy national security advisor of U.S. So
Nice.
The second discussion on the MIVA, I was at the same panel with the vice chancellor of Germany and also the managing director of the IMF and also CEO of the World Bank.
Christine Lagarde.
Yeah.
She was here today.
I found it's very stimulating and exciting, and I learned a lot. And I congratulate the organizer for such an excellent conference. It's rated the top think tank conference. I think it's really worth the credit on that.
Cool. China is rebuilding the Silk Road.
Yeah.
And which I think it's an enormous infrastructural project. Mm-hmm. It's very important economically and socially for the countries it passes through. I'm from Romania. Romanian too. Do you think that the Silk Road could pass through this country, for example?
Yes. Well, I think that China has been opened up for the last 4 decades, mm-hmm. and all the foreign companies come to China and build infrastructures and help the China World Bank and WTO, IMF, all are in China for the last 4 decades. Yeah. So China has benefited enormously of the world integration into China, and so China has actually developed its capacity. For example, China now runs the fastest speed train network in China. Mm. And if you now travel from Beijing to Shanghai, it takes you 4 or 5 hours by train. Enormous. Yeah. It used to take 2.5 hours by airplane. Now it takes 4 hours by plane.
Train.
If you cut off the airport distance, it was probably faster than airplane now. And also, China has been, for the last 10 years, since the financial crisis, we haven't seen any major development plans for the world. Mm-hmm. So I think that the world needs new impetus, new investment, new expertise and technology transfer. So China is probably willing to do that to help launch this Belt and Road Initiative.
Because everybody is impressed by the economical evolution of China. Very successful. So congratulations for that. Mm. Why do you think that is? What do you think China has that the rest of the world doesn't have?
I think that it's quite an interesting question. I was talking to a group of investors this afternoon. I mean, they're asking the same question. I think there's quite reasons for that. First of all, China was maintained stability and prosperity for the last 4 decades. I mean, at least building that. Mm-hmm. And also the Chinese culture, Chinese
internal stability.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, but also China is, they have a good planning actually. Mm-hmm. So now it runs the 13th 5 years plan. So every 5 years they do a plan. They have an exercise and the government allocated with a budget and then have a target to achieve. And then
it's like a company.
Yeah. It's measured by the KPI for all the officials.
Okay.
If you do well, you got promoted. If not, you got sacked. So so it's quite an efficient system. And then I think more than that, it was also the hard working. There are 300 million migrant workers working in China. I mean, they have a family behind. Mm-hmm. They're working long hours. And so it's really hard working and diligent people working there. And finally, I think China has caught up with its good time, is the globalization. The goods travel around the world, the internet is connecting everybody. For example, China has 1 billion smartphone users now. China become a cashless society. Everybody going out just using the mobile. They don't have to carry the wallet anymore. So there's a lot of efficiency generated about the communication and also cut down the transaction costs. So I think China has done right infrastructure-wise, communication-wise. It was going to increase the productivity. Mm-hmm. So that's why China is doing. Also, China has been stable. You know, it's not like sometimes in some government. You know, if you're changing the government, the successor will repeat all the predecessor's efforts. You know, start over again. Whereas China has been consistently working on a plan 5 years after not 5 years and not 5 years, mm-hmm. government after government after government. So that probably explains why China has been so effective and efficient.
It's interesting because China officially is a communist country, mm-hmm. but it has some capitalist spice.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
let's just say so.
Yeah,
my question is, how capitalist is Chinese communism?
I think what China has been achieved in the last, four decades basically, is that they combined. Government integration with the market forces. For example, China joined WTO. China has a large private sector. You know, like private sector hires 90% of the Chinese employment, generate 60% of Chinese GDP, and also over half of the revenues to the government, and also creating new jobs. So it's all private sector. But then sometimes the market forces can get out of control, so you have a strong regulation there. You have a strong government to manage that. So that actually made this working beautifully because of also the internationalization, globalization China has embraced. So I think all those helped China to become effective. But of course, there's a problem too. Like China, there's a lot of private sector complain. There's maybe there's a lot of. Bureaucracy, there's less efficiency. That's why Chinese government is now taking some actions on that. So it's not, you know, I think the system is not perfect, but at least it combined with the market economy with some planning exercise. Mm-hmm. So I think that probably, it's a hybrid if you want to.
So would you say it's a combination of two ideologies?
I think the ideology is basically they followed what Deng Xiaoping has said. You know, basically, it doesn't matter is a white cat or black cat.
As long as it catches mice, it's a good cat. I like that saying.
Yeah,
that's a good saying.
So you should give a little bit room for China to experiment, mm-hmm. and then let this system work out. Because also China has a unique situation. It's the largest country in the world. Has 1.4 billion people. Mm-hmm. So any unstable condition could lead to chaos, and we don't want China to export refugees or produce famine and things like that. Mm-hmm. So China now actually contribute to the over 30% of the world GDP growth, and has lifted 800 million people out of poverty. Accounts over 10% of the world population in the last 4 decades. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of things I think should be congratulated on China.
There is, and. I think it's very beneficial for the world as a whole. And taking all this into consideration, and as good as it all sounds, and it is, there are some politicians who critic China,
yeah.
who criticize China.
Yes.
Especially on disrespecting human rights, for mm-hmm. example.
Yeah.
And censoring the internet. I mean, YouTube is not available. I cannot be a YouTuber in China, for example. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. How do you respond to this? I mean, with all the openness of China, China's opening to the world, and it's clear that they're doing this.
Yeah.
Why isn't these sectors there yet?
Yeah. Well, I think that it probably takes time, you know, but you see all the multinationals are China, and... we are now in Germany, and the Volkswagen, Daimler Chrysler, and BMW sells more cars in China than Germany. And the same is true for GM and Ford sells more cars in China than the United States. So Walmart has about purchased 10 to 20% supplies from China for their supermarket chains. In China, in all the three or four or five star hotels, you can watch CNN, BBC, and all the Western media. So I think that one of the my personal guess is that one of the reasons that probably China has its own social media, so that there may be some protectionist on the domestic industry. But I think in the long run, you know, I'm in favor of opening that. You know, I'm not. I think that if we open all the media's at hotels, why can't we open the social network for our foreign guests? But also in China, as a matter of fact, if your foreigners come to China, if you have a foreign server, you can access Google YouTube and Twitters, as long as you have a local, you have a server from your home. So that it's not that 100% you cannot access. Also, there's a VPN available. Mm-hmm. You can access well. You know, like I know a lot of student researchers. Like also, for example, Tsinghua University, they have a Schwarzman program. It's a joint program founded by Blackstone Chair Schwarzman. So in the Schwarzman program, you go in, you can access anything you want. Mm-hmm. It's okay. Open. So it's not totally that you cannot, but I think that. I understand, you know, domestic industry development, but I think in the long run, I think this could be probably open in the future. You know.
Okay, that's good to know.
Yeah.
And you mentioned earlier, and it's very interesting, the fact that the United States is one of your biggest business partners.
Yeah.
And yet there is this trade war going on with the United States. What would you change about the United States? If you were to change one thing about the United States, what would it be?
I think that the China, U.S., you know, I mean, it's not a coincidence. You know, China was opened up for 40 years. But it's just China, again, also set up a diplomatic ties. It's 40 years with the U.S. So the process of China opening up is in the same pace with China-U.S. diplomatic relations, mm-hmm. which they established. So you can say when China opened, it was basically largely, I mean, one of the symbolic events was established diplomatic ties with the U.S. So I think the two countries are so much intertwined. They are the two largest economy in the world. They have so much trade going on. There's a student exchanges, like there's 500,000 Chinese students studying in the U.S., generated, you know, $20 billion revenue for the U.S. universities. And then every year there's 3 million Chinese tourists visiting the United States, generate another $30 billion. And all those not counted in the trade deficit. And after all, you know, I mean, since China opened up, there are 68,000 U.S. companies set up shops in China. I mean, U.S. companies generate $500 billion U.S. dollars revenue in China, much more than the trade deficit of $375 billion. Mm-hmm. And more than that, you know, a lot of this trade deficit actually was because of the U.S. company export. The famous story is that if you buy an Apple, $1,000 in the U.S. market, China probably made 20, 30 bucks on that. Mm-hmm. You know, so but then all the export value was counted from China. So I think we need to innovate the calculation system. We need to count the service trade, which U.S. has a huge surplus. But most of all, I think you know the tariff tactics posed by the President Trump is not a wise one because business in both countries doesn't like that. China's stock market will suffer, actually, 20 to 30% since the trade tension. And the U.S., whenever Trump has a Twitter, say, oh, we're going well, the market goes up. And then if the negotiation doesn't go well, the markets suffer. I mean, Apple actually suffer quite a bit. They make $50 billion in China, not because their revenue in China is coming down. The whole Apple price is, you know, has a big loss, recent few months. So you can see that the two countries it's so much intertwined, interconnected. Mm-hmm. If China-U.S. is solving their trade dispute, it benefit not both only two countries, but also the rest of the world. So I think you know I'm glad to see. I'm cautiously optimistic that the delegation of U.S. just finished the visit in China, and President Xi just met them in Beijing, and I hope that by March there will be solutions that are achieved by both sides. And I think that we can come back, and so the business community of both countries and the rest of the world, we have stable environment for continue to do business.
Okay, and what would you change about China?
Well, I think for China is that what I found actually at this conference, there's so many sections talking about China. Yet there's
an important topic.
That's
over
right.
The
but then there's not many Chinese was here. So I think China should really have a better
presence,
communication, have a better presence. Yeah, right. We already have a good presence. Like this year, we had the, our state leaders like Yang Jiechi, who is the director of CPC Foreign Affairs Office, was here. He spoke right after Vice President Pence spoke this morning. But I think, you know, in terms of other participant think tanks, we should have more. And also, like our think tank, the Center for China Globalization, we set up a side event. But it's only one side. There's about 6-7 event on China side event. There was only one think tank from China set up. There are all the rest, 7 of them, were set up by different think tanks.
Okay, so get involved more.
Yeah. So I think that probably China should communicate better and tell the story better to our friends outside China.
Okay. I think that's a very good advice. Mm-hmm. Thank you so much for being here today. Guys, I hope you enjoyed the interview. If you have any questions, please feel free to leave them in the comment section and talk to us using the hashtag YourMSC. I'll see you in the next one. Take care. Just me. Oh, yeah.